Yo, what's up? It's Nick Cannon, and when I'm in Charlotte, I'm watching the Chocolate Box.
Good evening and welcome to another fascinating episode of The Chocolate Box Presents. I am your host, Chocolate Drop, and as usual, you are in for a fascinating program. Tonight, we're going to take a look at Black history. Even though this is March, Black history is going to come around again. We know it is, it always does, and it's in February. But we're going to run this soon and then run it again next year. I am delighted to have as my guest, Mr. Maurice O. Johnson. Welcome to the program.
Glad to be here.
And we also have over there Mr. David Smith.
David Smith.
Welcome to the program.
Thank you.
And we're going to talk about the first 100 years, Black history, the first 100 years. So, Mr. Johnson, when did America get started?
America started in 1770. A group of citizens went to Boston House and was protesting against taxes. The British soldiers came out there and fired upon them. It just so happens the first man to die was Christus Attucks. This has started the United States of America.
It's on now, huh?
We can talk about taxation without representation. We can talk about governing ourselves. The next thing that happened was the Boston Tea Party.
What year was that?
In 1773.
Okay, 3 years later.
3 years later. They went aboard the ships, threw all the tea in the harbor.
We don't want your damn tea, right?
No, we don't want the tea.
Okay.
The British soldiers said, we're going to send an army over here to crush the rebellion. This has set up the Battle of Bunker Hill in 1775. To arm the Minutemen. And we, as Black men, we was part of the Minutemen who fought at Bunker Hill. In 1776, the states got together, put the direction of independence.
Okay, the Declaration of Independence.
Declaration of Independence.
Because we remember that year, that's 1776. That's one.
They took the Declaration of Independence over to King George. Mm-hmm. King George tore the Declaration of Independence up.
Get that out of here.
Yeah. And sent an army over. And he sent not only the British army, he sent a German army, the Prussians, over to put the upstarts down. Mm-hmm. And for the next 6 years, we fought the American Revolution. Mm-hmm. George Washington, because the British enlisted Black men, and George Washington said every Black man who fights with him will get his freedom.
That was incentive enough.
Mm, yeah. It was over 5,000 Black men who fought in the Revolutionary War. After the war ended, they became free men. They was no longer slaves, and nobody could put them in slavery. The next war was the War of 1812.
Compared to the War of
1812. The same with the British. On the sea, the British sailors, they started taking Americans off of the ships, mm-hmm. and the United States said, if you keep doing it, we're going to war. That started the War of 1812. Well, the British figured, They came in the first time, they burned down the White House. We pushed them back. They said, now we would have to have a port in order to land enough troops that we can move into inland into the United States.
Which port was that?
That was in Louisiana.
Okay. I can't think of the name of the port either, but it's in Louisiana. Okay.
It's in Louisiana, but this is...
Mr. Smith, you know the name of the port?
No,
Robert E. Lee?
Not Robert E. Lee.
Okay, that's all right. Let's keep going.
Okay. We fought the War of 1812. Mm-hmm. After the War of 1812, the war ended in 1814. And then, after that, they kicked us out of the Army and they kicked us out of the Navy. Mm. Though from that period of time, we were no longer in the military.
Okay.
But
and you said they kicked us out. You know, they kicked Black folk out of the Army and the Navy.
They, Purposely.
Purposely.
Anyone that was armed and had weapons mm-hmm. and knew how to use them, they kicked them out of the Navy, they kicked them out of the Army to make sure that no blacks would have arms and ammunition at this particular time.
So what happened with the right to bear arms? I think I know the answer to that.
The right to bear arms is a Second Amendment, and it did not include the men, the colored men in the country at that particular time. Mm. That was only for white men. And it said passed laws in the southern states that a black man couldn't own weapons, period, because he was starting to fight back. You're talking, who was Denmark Vesey?
Okay. Gabriel Prosser.
Gabriel Prosser and Nat Turner. Who was these people who was actually fighting back, you know?
Right.
And this is the reason that we don't want to have black men having guns and knowing how to fight back, because once we gained knowledge mm-hmm. of how to fight back and where we could go within the country, and then they set up the thing that it was a breakdown between the states, and there was two surveyors called Mason-Dixon
line.
Free state versus slave state. Mm-hmm. But that gives the black men and women in the country a process that they could actually get, if they go north, they can get free. Mm-hmm.
Now, was that around the Harriet Tubman period?
It was definitely during the Harriet Tubman period.
Okay.
But, we're leading up to that.
Okay.
And we're talking about the abolitionist period. And they was trying to incentivize people getting their freedom. Now, the thing about an abolitionist, most of them was not the ones that are going to fight back. They would hide you. They would feed you, and they would go to the next safe
house. That's part of the Underground Railroad.
Part of the Underground Railroad. Okay. When we talk about Harriet Tubman, we bring up one thing. In 1849, Harriet Tubman escaped for freedom.
Mm-hmm.
Technically, she's up in the state of New York, and she's a free woman.
Doesn't have to come back.
Don't have to come back. But she gets it in her mind that she was going to go back down south and help other slaves escape.
Risk death.
The reward for Harriet before in the 10-year period came up to over $40,000.
That's a lot of money.
That's a lot of money. The thing of it was, you have to talk, said, if you go back, they catch you, they're going to kill you. And also, they got people out there on the road looking for you. And I'm talking about looking high and low. They're trying to catch you because they know what you're doing. The reward started out around $5,000, then it went to $10,000, and then it went to $20,000. So the abolitionists got worried that Harriet was going to get captured. They said, well, go talk to Harriet and tell her that the reward for her capture is over $20,000. That's an enormous lot of money.
That's a lot of money now.
We're going to talk to her because we don't want her to come down here and get caught. And we don't want her because she's an important inspiration to hundreds of other people. Mm-hmm. They have given her the name Miss Moses.
Yeah.
And people are starting to escape. And more people are starting to escape because they know that we're looking for Harriet and we can't catch her. So they went and finally talked to Harriet and said, asked her about the reward. Said, mm-hmm. you know, the reward for your capture is over $20,000. And Harriet broke out laughing.
And why did she laugh?
She laughing so hard she started crying. what is so funny? So, when I was working in fields from sun up to sundown, from can't see to can't see, they didn't pay me not $1.
But now
I'm worth $20,000. If I'm worth $20,000 a day, what will I be worth tomorrow?
And to fast forward to Harriet Tubman, she did retire. She died natural causes,
She died a good life. She became a spy and a saboteur for the Union Army. Mm. She was receiving a military pension, and when she died with military funeral. That's with honors.
And she's up in Albany, New York.
Albany, New York, right now.
Now that should be a movie. Somebody needs to make a real true movie about Harriet Tubman.
But that's leading up to John Brown.
Okay. Oh, tell us about John Brown.
He was an abolitionist. He received the money to start his rebellion.
And he was a white guy.
Right? He was a white guy.
Okay.
His plan was, this is 1859, mm-hmm. his plan was to attack Harper's Ferry, get the ammunition and the guns and start a rebellion. The only thing, he didn't plan it well enough. He talked to Frederick Douglass before he went to Harper's.
You got a picture of Frederick Douglass right here in the back.
Harper's Ferry. They met in the city of Detroit. Mm-hmm. Frederick Douglass took up his cause, but he didn't join him in the attack. Mm-hmm. He was trapped at Harper's Ferry by Robert E. Lee, and in 1859 he was hung. Mm-hmm. And the thing that what they said, this was the opening salvo of the Civil War, when John Brown was captured.
That was the straw that broke the camel's
back. That was it. The slave owners, fearing that Abraham Lincoln was going to free the slaves, because he was elected president in 1860.
One year later,
they feared that he was an abolitionist. And the thing of it was, the Republicans was abolitionists and downright good people at that time.
Not to be confused with the Republicans today. Let's make that clear.
Okay. Not to be refused, but they was abolitionists and they were strong about and getting rid of the institution of slavery. You can't have slavery in a country that you say you are a free country with free men. And that always was thrown up to their backs. So they said, now, you take the Louisiana, that's the Louisiana Purchase, the Missouri Compromise.
Okay.
The Missouri Compromise stated that if before we bring a slave state in, we have to bring a free state in, because of the balance of power. You know, that was the Missouri Compromise. But when Abraham Lincoln became president in 1860, the next year, they was fearing that the Union was going to free all the slaves, and they opened fire on Fort Sumter, starting Civil War.
Fort Sumter, South Carolina.
Fort Sumter, South Carolina. Okay. Now, they said the war will be over within 6 months. Don't even worry about it. Keep my meal warm. I'll be back to get it.
We got this.
We got this. 2 years into the war, said if you want Abraham Lincoln, talk to Frederick Douglass and a few more of the abolitionists. If you want to win this war, you're going to have to bring in the black man. He was waiting for a victory to bring in the black man in order to, because for 2 years, the South was whipping the North to a standstill. They couldn't make a move. But he said, Robert E. Lee said, I'm not going to fight no more battles in the South. I'm going to fight in the North. And where he decided to cross into the North, we call it Antietam. They call it Shocksburg, Maryland.
Antietam, Shocksburg, Maryland.
Shocksburg, Maryland. That's where the Antietam Creek runs through. And that's where he was planning to bring his army up through the gap.
Some of our viewers know where that is, I'm sure.
Yep. Okay. One day of fighting. Mm-hmm. Up until that time, you might lose 5,000, maybe 6,000 men in a battle because of the type of weapons.
In one day.
Each battle that
they fought. 5,000 to 6,000 men were killed in one day.
In one day.
Okay.
Each battle, because of the type of weapons that we was using and the type of, you would line 1,000 men up and you would march 1,000 men toward another 1,000 men using rifled muskets. The only thing is, whoever gets off the best shot, who's better trained to shoot? Well, you didn't have to train them country boys how to shoot. Yeah. They knew how to shoot. All you had to do was train them how to march and how to stay in formation. And they was whooping the North for almost 2 years.
And you brought some weapons. Now, the weapons that you have here, do they tie into what was used back then? Or?
These are the exact weapons that was used during the Civil War. David will show you the Springfield.
Can you hold it up, David, so that our camera can get a good shot of that? I guess that would probably be on camera. Yeah, there we go. So talk to us about that a little bit now.
Go ahead, Dave.
What are you holding, David?
You go here. Springfield.
That's the name of the Springfield rifle?
That's Springfield rifle.
Okay, so what's so unique about the Springfield rifle?
The Springfield Armory was making weapons from the Revolutionary War up until the 40s, you know.
Okay. I have to ask you, I was questioning, are those still functional? Can they still fire?
Most definitely so. Oh. You put powder, shot, ram it down in there, and then they came up with what they call nabol. Mm-hmm. This means that it didn't need no packing. Mm-hmm. All you had to do was put grease on it, and shove it down the barrel, and when they explode it, it widens out. That's how you got your rifle in. Okay.
So now that was a Springfield. What is this one?
That's an Enfield.
Enfield.
And that comes from England.
Okay. And that's the same time period?
Same. The North was getting weapons from England, and the South was getting weapons from England.
Well, England made out like a fat rat.
The idea, your army, thousands of men, and can you have your arsenals started printing out the cannons, the pistols, the rifles, and everything else you need, so you go to other countries and get weapons that you need. The two most popular was the Enfield and the Springfield.
Well, I know that you've got a lot of material here, and there's so much that we need to cover in such a short period of time. So the history is just awesome. I mean, we can just talk about the history alone, but I do want to see some of the artifacts as well as sharing with our viewers. So kind of run through what we have over here.
David, all right, real quickly, this was a holster that was used usually by someone that was either a lieutenant or higher rank. This was a weapon that they used, a handgun, that was used by someone in higher rank, such as a lieutenant or whatever. This was a knife. Some had it, some carried it, some didn't. But usually they had pretty close with what was called a bowie knife. And there was two styles of them. One was with the wooden handle and one was with the black handle. As we can see, different styles of the knife.
And they would just shove that carry into somebody, right? That was just...
When you get close enough and you can't arm your, you use a knife.
It was a variety of things also. You could also cook with this. You could cut your trees down with or whatever you needed. You had your knife, you could use it for you. And you could use it in battle. Usually they used the weapon and they used a bayonet, and the bayonet was a weapon of choice to put on your rifle. But most of the times you fired one time, and by then they were up on you. So what you would do is take the butt of your gun and beat them to death with it. Most people were clubbed to death more so than shot. And this is the gun box that comes along with it. You got like a cap box where you hold your caps, and these little caps you put on top of the rifle. And it fires off, and these are small balls that were used in the handgun, but they use a 54 or 58 caliber in a rifle. Now these were the buckles that went around the side to hold all your equipment on. They gave you gloves, but you usually ended up losing things like that. You had a canteen and a haversack, and what you did is you went around and they give you suspenders, and you had your plate and your forks that you usually carry out. But these types of things always got lost. And one of the most important things that you had to have, and a most important person that usually was with you, was your bugler. Because in a battle, when everything is being fired and all the smoke, you can't hear a thing, you can't see a thing. But when the bugler sounded which direction you wanted to go, or that your lieutenant or general or sergeant, whoever, you could hear the bugler over everything, and that would tell you if you would make a right wheel turn, a straight or a retreat, whatever it was. The bugler, he was a very important person, so he usually was around the captain or the lieutenant or whatever, and that they use that. Now, this signifies like a sergeant. It goes around his waist, and that's what he put on his waist. And usually his spenders, like I said, boxes that they carried in the handguns. And mostly that's what they did. They would eat hardtack. Hardtack was a real hard biscuit that they would usually soak in a coffee, but it wasn't really coffee. They use chickweed. If they had coffee, it would have been good. But usually they had chickweed because chickweed was something that grew around everywhere. So it was okay to take chickweed because it tastes similar to coffee. And one of the things they did was they do what they call gathering. And they would go out and they would use these hats to fill it up with food. And they would put food all in here and they would porch any farms or wherever. They would get eggs and all the other stuff that went along with it. And that's how it went with getting the food that you want. Now, usually most of the food was rotten. So they would somewhat cook rotten food. So a lot of people got sick. A lot of people died off the food. Most of the people died from consumption. So basically, that's what you had to deal with. You had to have, you also had a big sack, probably weighing about 100 pounds or so with everything on it, along with your raincoat.
So quick question. So how did you all go about amassing, acquiring, obtaining all of the artifacts that you have there? And I understand this is only a third of what you have in your full arsenal. So how did you go about it? Donations or what?
No, you go out to settler stores and buy them.
Okay.
And the idea is when you go out to a settler store, you have to be in uniform. You have to wear a uniform from a certain period. And everything had to be authentic at that particular time.
So this uniform that you all have, tell us about the uniform that you all have on.
The uniform that we have on, I'm a sergeant, the vest.
You mic now, so you can't go too far.
Okay. The light blue pants, dark blue jacket. The hat that tells the infantry. That's the sign of the bugle, what company I'm in, and the 102nd is my regiment. And we have, when we go out to different encampments, mm-hmm. we have what we call a Civil War police. And they'll come around into your encampment, and they'll just sit there and take notes. If you're not in authentic uniform or someone's wearing gym shoes or something like this, they ain't going to tell you. They ain't going to say nothing to you. But they will send a letter to your unit and tell you, said, now, if you can't be in uniform and you don't want to be in period, don't come back.
Okay. And so now this represents what year?
This is 1861.
This is 1861.
All the way through, even the Buffalo Soldiers wore the blue and light blue pants, only the difference was be the stripes. I wear a blue stripe, they will wear a yellow stripe. And they kept that uniform for quite a few years.
So somebody who really knows, they can look at you and automatically tell a whole history just on what you're wearing.
Just on what we're wearing.
One other important thing that most people don't realize, they would issue you shoes when they did issue shoes. And when they issued, they would issue
you
these
brogans. Can you step a little bit further, forward a little bit?
They would give you these brogans. But it wouldn't matter what foot you put it on because they didn't have no right or left foot. You would just stick it on your feet.
I don't think we're getting that shot. Director, can we get a shot of the shoes, please?
And they would issue you these socks. Well, these were American Revolutionary socks, but these were issue socks from the government to wear. And they usually would issue just one, and you had to take care of it, but that never happened. But the shoes itself was just leather shoes with leather ties. And the significant part was it's either right foot or left foot. You can put it on either foot. Mm. Terrible. They're not comfortable at all. Hard to get along with, but that's what you had. It was better to have shoes than to go barefoot.
And they weren't Nikes for sure, right?
That's for sure.
We're running towards the end of our program. You brought these other pictures and some documents. Can you kind of give us a brief synopsis of what do we have here? And remember your mic.
Okay. A little bit. It's from the Revolutionary War with the urging of Frederick Douglass and other abolitionists. And the end of the war in 1865, the General Lee was defeated and the 13th Amendment to the Constitution was passed. The 13th Amendment to the Constitution ended slavery, period. In 1867, they are free people, but are they American citizens? Mm-hmm. The 14th Amendment to the Constitution says, if you was born within the United States of America, you are a free person just by the idea that you was born in this country. The next amendment to the Constitution is the 15th Amendment. This is the 100 years from 1770 to 1870. Mm-hmm. In 1870, you have the right to vote. Theoretically, we have all the rights of an American citizen. Back in 1870, if they don't take it away from us. Mm-hmm. Like they have did in the past, and they're trying to do the same thing in the future.
Trying to get it renewed. And so you got Jacob M. Howard. Who is Jacob M. Howard?
Jacob M. Howard was a senator from Michigan, mm-hmm. and he...
He was a senator from Michigan.
He was the one, a Republican, he mm-hmm. pushed through the 13th, 14th, and 15th Amendment to the Constitution.
Was that a good thing or a bad thing?
That is definitely a good thing.
Okay.
He died in office. Mm-hmm. And to attribute to Jacob N. Howard, he died in 1871. His obelisk is half finished. No, it's not. They don't have the top on it.
Where's it located?
It's located in Elmwood Cemetery. Okay. But they put the 13th Amendment on his obelisk.
Because the 13th Amendment, the reason why it has to get a lot of attention now with regards to Michelle Alexander's book about mass incarceration, it talks about the 13th Amendment.
If you want to take an amendment to the Constitution and use it, you can take that the Second Amendment, the First Amendment, or any amendment that you want to use. But the whole idea about the 13th Amendment was freeing people, period, except for incarceration. They are misusing a lot of the amendments to the Constitution, freedom of speech, the Second Amendment, and the Fourth Amendment. But it's up to us as people
to know your rights.
To know your rights. I mean, if you don't know your rights, if I tell you that we got an election coming up and only 35% show up, then only 35% is going to be representative, and that's not enough to get anything done. Yeah. We have to show up at 65 and 75% to actually get something done. And we have that right to vote.
In remaining 2 minutes or so, any final things? It's important that if you had nothing else to say to people watching this program as it relates to the first 100 years Black history, what would it be?
Your right to vote.
See, you summed that up right. Well, I know you got a lot of other stuff on there. We could take a look at some of we didn't get to. We apologize to our viewers for that. At some point, we may very well have to have you come back and maybe even see the rest of your exhibit.
Well, I mean, it had to be a lot bigger.
And more time.
But the thing of it is, why was the first 100 years so important?
Why was the first 100 years so important?
Because we fought these wars, and we achieved the purpose that we were supposed to, and we have all the rights that we need.
And on that note, it's customary on the Chocolate Box that we like to end our program by offering our guests an opportunity to participate in a little ritual we call the eating of the chocolate. So I want to thank you, Mr. Maurice Johnson, and Mr. David Smith for appearing on tonight's episode of the Chocolate Box Presents. I would like to encourage the viewers to tune in each week, same day, same time, for another fascinating episode of the Chocolate Box. I am Chocolate Drop. We'll see you next week.
Thank you.
And make sure you vote and listen to what Mr. Johnson was saying. This is Theotry Green here. I am appealing to those who watch any program I've ever done at Public Access. And we need more volunteers. We need people to come and learn how to produce their own programs. So if you ever had any interest in knowing what happened behind the scene, get involved with Public Access. We need directors, definitely directors. We need people who are proficient with audio, lighting, set, graphics, the whole nine yards. I've been doing this longer than I care to admit, but I can only do it because of the dedicated volunteers that help to make my programs happen. One of the programs I do is titled The Chocolate Box Presents. It comes on every Tuesday at 9 p.m. right here on Charlotte Mecklenburg's Access Channel, which is Spectrum Channel 21. You could also see it on UVerse. So come on down and get involved in producing your very own program at Public Access Channel 21. Hey, Chocolate Drop here from the Chocolate Box TV. Hey, in addition to loving chocolate, I bet you also didn't know that I love to hike. That's why when I'm hiking, I've got my hiking boots, I've got my Camelback for my water, and I've got my backpack, because when you're hiking, you never know what you're going to get. Kind of like watching the Chocolate Box every Tuesday evening at 9 p.m. on Time Warner Cable Channel 21. Like us on Facebook at facebook.com/thechocolateboxTV and Vimeo's /TXTV/videos.